So I've only met him yesterday. It's actually his first talk today, so be gentle. And Joost is from the Netherlands, and he told me how he bakes oliebollen on the 31st of December, and I thought, wow, it's so traditional. but then he said that he cannot ice skate.
True.
That's true, yeah. And I was like, okay, not that traditional. However, he's the one who fixed a breaking bug in Angular compiler. And yeah, and he will tell you everything about compilers right now, right?
Yeah, probably. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So let's welcome him on stage with an applause and let him start.
Hi, folks. I'm excited to be talking to you today about Angular's template type checker. But since we are in Belgium here, an alternative title for this talk could have been The Template Type Checker, using the alliteration convention of the Siska and Wiske comic series by Willy van der Steen. I couldn't keep that joke out. So, a bit more about me then. It's funny that this picture shows a canal frozen. Well, I cannot ice skate. That's actually how we came to the introduction bit. My name is Joost, and I'm from Utrecht in the Netherlands. A picture is on the right. I work full-time as a software engineer at a Dutch company called Blurik. And besides that, I've also been part of the Angular team since 2018, a couple years now. And since then, I have primarily worked on the Angular compiler. I helped build the partial compilation mode for libraries together with Pete, did deep dives into improving the compiler performance across the board, and have made contributions to the template type checker. And that last topic is what today's talk is all about. In the first part, I will show some of the capabilities of template type checking, as well as its configuration options and some of its more advanced features. In the second part, we'll look behind the scenes of how the Angular compiler is able to achieve checking of your templates. All right, let's dive in. First, what is template type checking and why is it useful? Let's take a look at a small example where we have a component that renders a child component and binds a value to its greeting input. Notice that the greeting property is typed to be nullable. When we look at the greeting component, however, notice that the input is not nullable. This means that the greeting component will fail to render when it uses the greeting input in its template. As you see here, it basically reads the message property from greeting. And it assumes that there will always be a value there because greeting is not declared as being nullable. But then when we compile this program, we get an error from the compiler, and it's telling us that this is going to blow up. It attempted to bind the nullable greeting property in the app component to this non-nullable input binding, and this might blow up, so you're getting error for that. And the error shows you precisely where in the template this occurs, and it explains kind of what the issue is. So you get a very nice explanation as to what's going on. But now, how to fix this error? If you look at the app component again, we can update the template to only show the greeting component when a greeting is actually available. And we can accomplish that using the NGF directive, which you're probably all familiar with. And once we've done this change, then rebuilding the project again will now succeed because we have solved the error. And that's basically how the template type checker is capable of preventing bugs before you were even able to discover them while maybe testing your application in your browser. And there are a lot more examples where the template type checker has your back. If you misspelled a property name, for example, or have some method invocation where you pass in incorrect arguments or forgot to pass an argument, something like that, then you also know immediately from the type check errors that you get. The template type checker is also a very valuable tool once you start refactoring your code. It's just not just making it once and it works, but then you start to make changes and it's a bit tricky to find all of the occurrences that are now relevant to be updated. All right, that was kind of an introduction to what type checking can offer. And let's take a step back to learn about the various type checking modes that Angular has to offer. It's a bit complicated. So from the early days of Angular, only the template expressions were type checked. There was no type checking of, for instance, pipes, and everything that occurred within embedded view, so that was a structural directive like ngif and ng4, would also not be type checked at all. The compiler and TypeScript back then was simply not capable of doing this. And then around the time of Angular 5, we extended the type checking capabilities with more exhaustive checks, where we did gain the ability to type check pipes and also embedded views, among some other things. However, we wanted to avoid a breaking chains upon our users, so this new feature was introduced behind a compiler option named full template type check. And this was an all-in option, right? You enabled the option and then you got all of the new type checking capabilities. And then with Angular Ivy in version 9, we realized that we could take it even further. Thanks to advances to the TypeScript language, we were able to achieve much more extensive type checking. And releasing these changes under the existing full template type check flag would have been yet another breaking change. So we need a kind of a better strategy for dealing with this. And that's how the strict template kind of family of flags was introduced, which has several sub-options that we'll take a look at as well a bit later. But we're now kind of in a confusing state, right, with all of these different options. So that's why we've decided to deprecate the full template type check option starting in Angular 13. It's still around, but you should probably migrate to using strict templates because you can set up your configuration exactly as full template type check turned on behaved with the new family of strict template options. And if you look at the individual capabilities of these modes, you'll find that strict templates will check input binding expressions actually against the type of an input of the directive that you're binding against. It will also be able to infer the type of $event, for instance, in output bindings, and it can even infer the generic types of directives such as ng4, like reason about the iterate type of everything that you're iterating over. And we'll have a look at how to make your own directives that take that can leverage these options using some tricks that we offer. Now, how do you start to use this? You should go into your tsconfig.json file, and you can see probably that it's already there an Angular compiler options object. And in the case of full template type check, you can just set it to true, and then you have that option turned on. But realistically, since that option is deprecated, you should probably enable strict templates. And once you do that, you can also just get rid of full template type check because strict templates cover all of the same features. And if you have been using the Angular CLI to create all of your projects, then you will automatically get strict templates turned on because it enables strict mode by default. All right, I mentioned that there are also these sub-options that come with the strict template options. And I've listed them, all of them here. I won't go into detail about any of them, but you can just go to angular.io to read more about them if you're interested. And sometimes it's useful to have this escape hatch, because if you start to enable these more strict type checking configurations, then there might be cases where the compiler starts to report errors where you don't really have a nice way to avoid that error, for instance. And maybe there's a strictness flag that you might be able to disable to opt out of that error, but perhaps you want that error in 90% of the cases and just a few occurrences that you can't easily fix. And this is where you can opt into using the $any escape hatch, which is a magic function that's available in template expressions that casts the type of the expression to be the any type. And that effectively disables any type check errors that would have otherwise occurred there. This any helper is compiled away in your application, so you won't see it when debugging, for instance. It won't be present in the generated code. All right, that was basically a kind of an overview of the template type checking capabilities of the compiler. And now I wanted to show you what you can do yourself to improve the experience of your custom directives, for instance, in contributing mostly static fields to improve the type checking experience of your own projects. And maybe you're a library author and you want to offer these kinds of experiences as well, like we do for NG4 and NGF. And the first thing we'll look at is how to type the template context object for structural directives. And I'll actually go a bit into the detail of what I mean by this, because it's probably a bit abstract for some of you. So let's look at an example of the NG4 directive. It renders a list of persons and their index in the list. And the variable declarations that are shown in underlined yellow receive their values from the template context that is created by the NG4 directive when it renders each of the person items. This is what the template context object for the NG4 directive looks like. We have a well-defined interface for that. There's a bit more properties in there as well, but I'm showing a subset of them. And let's now consider the template and its context interface next to each other to see how this all works. The binding expression of a structural directive uses the so-called microsyntax, which is syntactic sugar for an NG template declaration. And I won't show you the fully desugared NG template here because it's not really relevant. But one thing we can do to make it more clear is to see what's going on, is to make the implicit binding that corresponds with the $implicit property of the interface, to make that explicit in the microsyntax you see on the top. So we can do that by assigning the $implicit property from the context object into the person variable declaration. You see that here in the gray $implicit syntax in the top. And this is still valid microsyntax. It's luckily not something you will ever have to write in real code, because like the $implicit is really implicit. So you never see it, but you can do this. And now it becomes more clear how the microsyntax corresponds with the context object. And the same is also true for the I variable declaration in yellow on the right. It gets its input, it gets its value from the index property of the context interface. So that's how the $implicit is connected, and then the other one is connected using the index property. And now that we know how the template variables person and I are related to a template context object and its interface, the one remaining challenge to derive their types is to actually know that NG4 of context is the relevant object interface to use for the NG4 directive. Because in this template, we have only really used the NG4 directive using its selector. But how is the template type checker able to infer kind of that the NG4 of context interface is also relevant in this case? The answer to that question is the declaration of a special static method on the directive class. The name of this method must be NG template context guard, and it must have two parameters. The first parameter has the type of the directive itself, and the second parameter receives the template context where its type can still be anything, so it's of type unknown here. We can't make any assumptions about the type, but it doesn't matter for how we use it. The return type of this method uses some special TypeScript syntax to indicate that this function is a so-called type guard for the parameter context in this case. If the function returns true, then TypeScript will assume from that point onward that the type of context is actually an NG4 of context and no longer this unknown type as it was initially before this function was invoked. If the directive has any generic type parameters like the T type parameter in this example, we have to repeat those again in this static method, because the static method itself doesn't reach into the generic type parameters of the class, because it's static, it's not yet bound to any T yet. And this is why the first parameter takes the directive's own type. When a directive instance with T being equal to, for instance, person is present in your template, then we pass that as an argument to this method. And that allows TypeScript to make the connection between that directive, which has a concrete type of person, in which case we know that T is a person, so that we get also out an ng4 of context of type person. And then we know that its implicit property is no longer some abstract T, but actually a person, what we're interested in. And the actual method implementation, as you see here, is irrelevant. The type checker is only ever interested in the type side of this method. It won't look at the implementation. Returning false here, for instance, also won't make a difference in how this behaves. And later on, we get to see behind the scenes how the template type checker uses this static method definition to actually make this work. And although you declare it like this, you never have to call it yourself. So it's taken care of behind the scenes. All right. Time for a big deep breath now, I think. That was quite a lot. Luckily, it gets a bit easier from now on. And what I wanted to talk about are template guards. And for this feature, it's typically that you look at the ng-if directive. It is a structural directive that only renders the template below it when its input expression evaluates to a truthy value. And consequently, for the template type checker, this means that the type checker should be clever enough now that reading the name property from person should be okay, even if person was initially nullable, for instance, in its type. As because of the ng-if directive, person can never be null anymore or undefined within that template anymore. And that's where the context guard becomes relevant. And it uses a similar strategy, where in this case the ng-if directive declares a special static field. And the name of this field is prefixed with ng-template-guard, and then an underscore, and then the name of the input binding. And the type of this field must be the literal string type binding. And this is a hint to the template type checker that the expression that was bound to the ngif input should be used as the guard for the inner template of this ngif directive. And again, we'll later see what this means for the generated code. And like I said, the suffix of this static field has to correspond with the field name that receives the input binding. You can even have multiple of these static fields if you want to guard use multiple inputs as a guard. And then one last thing is how directives can have this concept called input type coercion, where sometimes you have some input that can take multiple types of values. And an example of this would be a disabled input, for instance, where you can use this helper from the CDK to convert any value that looks like a Boolean value into an actual true or false value. But then when we start using this property like this in a template, which is quite common for a property like disabled, you then get an error like this. And this error is a bit confusing, because it starts to reason about like the string type. Where does the string type come from? We never typed a string, right? But what it is actually a shortcut for in such a case is that at runtime, if there's no value assigned to an attribute, which does correspond to a directive input, then it gets the value of an empty string. And we mimic this in the template type checker. So if there is no input expression, then the type checker will make it an empty string. And that's where the string comes from. However, if you look again at the setter implementation, you can see that it can only take Boolean types. So that empty string is not allowed as a valid value for that input. And a limitation of TypeScript was that it used to require that the type of a setter is identical to the type of the getter. So the ones in yellow here had to align. You couldn't make the setter take a wider type than the getter did. However, this is kind of limiting for us because our setter does convert or does accept more than just Boolean values. It also takes like string values and converts to, and they are converted to actual Boolean values using this coerced Boolean property helper. And we had to build a trick into this, into the template type checker for this as well. Using another static field, like we could have probably guessed by now. And you have to name this static field using ng-accept input type as prefix, and then again an underscore, and then again the name of the input that you want to control the type more closely of after that. And the type of this field indicates the type of the values that the input is actually capable of handling. And whenever the template type checker comes across a field like this, it will redirect from using the setter to actually using this type instead. Well, it's a bit annoying, right? Because our setter implementation still only takes Boolean values, so its type isn't even accurate. But we couldn't do better in older versions of TypeScript. Luckily, the TypeScript team also realized that this was a limitation, and they fixed this not specifically for us, but just for the TypeScript language in general, with TypeScript 4.3. And we support that version since Angular 12. So now there's a valid alternative available. We have decided to make this kind of static fields deprecated, because you should really be using the native TypeScript feature. And the ng-accept input type fields are now obsolete. So the alternative then, since TypeScript 4.3, is to just have the setter accept a wider type and the real type that you actually accept at runtime. It's now allowed for the setter to take, for instance, a Boolean or an empty string, while the getter still has just the type of Boolean. And this is even beneficial in terms of type safety, because now the setter is forced to deal with that string value. You can no longer forget, for instance, coerce Boolean property, as you could before. All right, that were all the capabilities that you as a developer can leverage to achieve more accurate type checking for your own directives. And now let's have a look at making this all work behind the scenes. In essence, what a compiler does, it generates TypeScript code for your Angular templates, specifically for the purposes of type checking. And we call this TypeScript code the TypeCheck block. And in this code, again, only the types are relevant, because we never ever actually get to execute this code at runtime. So let's look at a very simple component template then, to see what its template TypeCheck block looks like. And it's in basically just a function which takes the component type as parameter. And within the TCB, we then instantiate all the directives that are being used using the input expressions from the template, where property reads have been translated to read fields from the context parameter instead of just being bare property reads. And this is how we verify that the expressions refer to known fields in the component class, so you can no longer make typos. We also assign the input expression into the directive instances. And that allows us to verify that the type of your inputs actually align with the types of what the directives expect for that input. So if you make a mistake there, like the nullable example in the very beginning, you get an error for it. And in this example, you also see how the binding expression of ngif is being used as a guard expression for the inner template block at the bottom. And this allows the TypeScript compiler to now narrow the type of context.greeting to be truthy within that if block. And that's why we no longer get an error if context.greeting would have otherwise had a nullable type. And to support directives with generic type parameters, we need a bit of a trick to declare the directive's type in the TCB. It's not valid to just say, oh, I have this variable of type ng4 of t, because there is no t yet, so we have to employ yet another trick to make this work. And we solve this problem using so-called type constructors. These are function declarations that are automatically generated by the template type checker, and they take a single argument. That argument should be an object literal containing all of the inputs of the directive. And the type of this object is automatically derived from the actual directive class using TypeScript pick helper. It creates a new object with just a subset of the original properties. And then this function is typed to declare or to return the directive type itself. And once we have this type constructor, we can use it to infer the correct type arguments from your template's input expressions. And this allows TypeScript to infer the type t from the type of context.persons in this example. All right. One last thing I will show is how template context guards are applied. We looked at them before, how we can actually specify them as a static member. The ng template context guard for ng4, for instance. And now let's see how the template type checker uses this field to infer the type of the template context object. If we look at the TCB, the static field is used as a guard expression of an if block. Initially, the type of the context object is declared as just any, because we haven't discovered yet what the actual type should be. But remember that the context guard function is a type guard function. It has this special return type that specifies that context is indeed an ng4off context type. And this means that within the if block, the TypeScript compiler will have narrowed the type of the context variable to be the type as indicated by that guard function. And in this case, this means that we've successfully derived that the context object is indeed an ng4off context, where T is of type person. And that means that now our dollar implicit property also is of type person, which is exactly what we wanted. And if you're ever interested in viewing this TCB, because it happens all behind the scenes, you can use the Angular Language Service plugin for Visual Studio Code, because you can search for an action to just view template type check block. And then it will open a new editor, which shows basically the code I was just showing to you as well. All right, all these type check blocks are generated, but we actually need to put them somewhere to also ask TypeScript of where are the errors are. And this is why the compiler creates so-called shim files. And they have this special ng-typecheck.ts extension for each of the input source files of your program. And we kind of are clever in a way that if you use kind of in an incremental rebuild, you don't want to recreate all of the type check blocks for all of your components, because that would be expensive. So we have kind of heuristics in place to know when certain or how the changes you make to your program actually affect if your type check blocks can still be reused or if they need to be regenerated. And then there's one more missing piece to the puzzle. TypeScript will type check our TCBs in the type check files. But that also means that the errors are reported in those magic type check shim files. However, it wouldn't be nice for us to show you these errors in these kind of vague files. So what we want to do is we want to translate those diagnostics to be actually targeted towards the original template code. And we use yet another trick to accomplish this, where we litter the TCBs with comment nodes containing the start and end offsets of where the expression originally existed in the template. So what I just shown you right just now is actually not exactly what we do. It looks more like this. And any diagnostics that TypeScript reports are translated to their originating template location by just finding the nearest offset comment. We then look even further up the tree to discover in which type check block this occurs. And we have internal memory in the compiler's internal memory. We track which type check block function corresponds with which original template. So with these offsets, we can then just show the errors in the original template. And also there's this ignore marker, which you notice, for instance, in the invocation of the type constructor. Because as you see, the context.greeting property read occurs multiple times. It occurs when we instantiate the ngif directive. It occurs again when we assign that input into the directive, the ngif property of that directive instance. And it occurs again in the context guard, in the if statement. But if there is a typo in that expression, then we don't want to report it three times in this case. So that's why we silence basically the errors using the ignore marker for the type constructor and for the guard expression, so that you only get the error from actually assigning it into the ngif field. All right, that was basically all of the magic there is to it. So what we've learned is that you can configure the template type checking process using the strict templates option and its fine-grained sub-options. Then we went through the features that developers can use to improve the type checking experience for their own directives. And then lastly, we've seen how this is all made to work behind the scenes. If you want to read more about what I've just shown, we have extensive developer documentation on Angular.io, so you can learn more about this. And for an even more deep dive, you can take a look at the TypeCheck package of the compiler, because it contains a README markdown file, which is very extensive in its explanation of how this all works. So if you're interested, definitely check that out. And that was it.